exhibited her work since the late 90s, and among these exhibitions she specifically remembers the Münster Sculpture Project, which was in 2007, the Venice Biennial in 2011, 13 and 15, Documenta 13 in 2012, and the Macho Cow Plant exhibition in 2015. I remember very well the Leipzig exhibition that you did.
Yes.
And I know. It's just that this Leipzig exhibition, which I think I'd like to know about it, is that it also relates very much to the topic that we're addressing today, the questions of archival practice in relation to its actuality.
Yeah, I thought I wanted to say something about the film, so that you know what you see. So this is a chapter of a longer film, which is about a meeting, a psychoanalyst, Oscar Masota, who died in Barcelona, was born in Argentina and died in Barcelona. And there are two things that are important to know. One is that he, for 1 year he was an artist in 1966, and in this year that he was an artist, a happenista, he made three happenings. And this is one of the happenings that he made. Apart from that, he was a Lacanian who translated Lacan into Spanish, and he was the introducer of the work of Lacan in the Spanish-speaking world, which is quite quite an achievement, quite something. I wanted to work about him because of these two things, relation of performance and psychoanalysis. In this chapter we're going to see, which is El Helicóptero, I call it a repetition of this happening that took place in 1966. Okay, I think this is the minimum I want to tell more about this. This is the minimum. So now you can see, perhaps afterwards you have questions. I have something to say that it was followed the Masota left a very accurate description of this happening in a text that is called "I Committed the Happening," and it's everything is following his description. description. So this is one point perhaps is interesting. Another point that is obvious but maybe it's not bad to say is that nothing is scripted, so all the conversations are people, I mean the public is a real public. They are not actors, it's just people who want to attend to the
without knowing what they would.
Well, they knew it was called El Helicóptero, so they were expecting an helicopter.
I think it was a fantastic film. Thank you for showing it. I think it makes sense in the context of how we narrate history. Because I don't know if I'm getting the term right, but it's more like the like empirical history. Because I gave a whole historical context, which is based on data and information, but of course it's filtered not by what Masota might have think that it was a rumor. And what's interesting in the film is how that rumor comes true and then other fictions start to arise and the mass psychology that he was interested in. No? Also, I think in relation to how we relate with social media, there is more and more pop psychology term of FOMO, no? Of fear of missing out. No? Yeah. Yes, FOMO, fear of missing out. And that's what happens with the second wave of the visitors that are... what did we miss? Yeah. What did we miss? And the feeling of guilt, no? Like, oh, we missed it. No, I think he was in the forefront. Yeah. And in relation to the art community itself, although that wasn't, I guess, his interest, I think, well, personally, because I recognize some people, some artists, so I guess also when we're in a normal opening, also all these things happen, like people get together for something, but most of the conversations are about nothing, no? Or about things that are not there. And you know, I had a question about the instruction itself or the what Masota wrote, was it meant to be on a cliff, outdoor, or was that your choice to be on the cliff?
Well, there was simultaneity of two situations, one in a theater and one in an open space. And the open space, in his case, was an abandoned train station. In this case, it was an edit, because it was done in the Bay Basque country. Because that was the circumstance, so we chose this. We had to coordinate because it's a lot of timing. That's why the text is called A Comedy is a Happening, because he said he was planning it as you plan the hold up of a bank. So when the bus has to leave, when it has to arrive, when people have to leave the theater, when the helicopter has to arrive, when it has to leave. So all this was super planned. Minutes by minutes, so this minute the helicopter has to leave now because otherwise the people coming with the buses will see the helicopter and they can't possibly see the helicopter. So this is, we really stick to, we even left at the same time that Masota left, which was 2 in the afternoon, and that's why everybody's hungry because it's the time that you eat in Spain. And even if I told everybody to take sandwiches, you know. Some people didn't take the sandwich and then they were very hungry. Yeah.
So we had a perfect timing with the sandwiches. Did you have a question or was I misinterpreting the gesture?
I think you misinterpreted, but
I
do have a question. it's telepathy. To me, it's very interesting, the film, because I think that it reconnects to many other presentations throughout the day. And exactly because the instructions were in the 60s, I was thinking about spectatorship and tourists, which, so the very direct question to Dora is like, how do you think like this kind of spectatorship has changed from the 60s until now? Because that kind of spectatorship that in the 60s probably was addressing a very specific audience, which was pertinent specifically to the art world, nowadays is shifting again to the art world, but which is a very a different one. And I also thought that you recreate a complete, it recreates a complete different expectations. And even though the film doesn't directly address that, I think that throughout your presentation, but also the previous one of Cosminas, in rebuilding this history, the spectatorship has completely changed and it has become a global one. That doesn't mean that the audience has been enlarged, but simply that it's the audience which is migrating from place to place. I don't know if that's been very clear, but it's just, yeah.
I think in this case the situation was very, very similar to the one of Masota, in the sense that it was an art public, and in the case of Masota it was an art public as well, because it was done in the Torquato de Tella. So it was made of artists, almost 100% made of artists, the public then, and it was almost 100% made of artists now too. And so it was a very analogic performance in that sense, and it was coincident with the opening of a museum, so it was some sort of international audience, but not too much. Most of the international audience were artists that were in the exhibition, so they had to come. So I think it's a very analogical, it does not reflect what you say, which is true, this kind of cloud of people that repeats itself in every event, again and again, and also like in the film of Nora as well, this idea of being there but not really being there, the kind of public that has no time really to see the show but goes and buys the catalog, hoping that this will do, that they can check it while they go on the plane, and then this will do for the experience of seeing the exhibition. So this is a phenomenon that repeats itself more and more. People who write about biennales, with being 15 minutes in the biennale, this kind of stuff is not rare. It's not rare at all. It happens all the time. So in this case, yes, but it was not, the helicopter was not like that. The helicopter was, yeah, it was very analogic. It was like, I think it was not really far from the 60s.
Can I ask, actually, it's a question that maybe we can broaden out to all the speakers so far. And it sort of bounces off that one, which is a straightforward question. What are contemporary conditions do you think that make this historical return so attractive? It's a very lay question in many ways, but one of the things that strikes me about so many of the presentations today is that fixation on sight, and that is really interesting.
Fixation on what?
Sight. So a lot of the... site, there's the place.
Oh,
yeah,
okay.
Site.
Okay. Sorry.
So with the video, so much of the footage is of the landscape in focus and the people are not. With and of course it's a shift from Masota's happening to, as you said, the Basque. So on the 12th of September, which is, itself has interesting resonances for the parallax of time. With Inti's, there's this sense of Tate in this project space, which is kind of like the non-profit space of Tate at the time. A time when Tate was being accused of cannibalizing their kind of artist-run space, as well as some of the politics associated with Liberate Tate and so forth, which resonate quite interestingly with some of the material that you're looking at, whether that came. You know, wasn't actually specific in that way, that shift from group material in relation to Central America to Tate's own quite problematic politics. So there are some really interesting things, but what are some of the contemporary conditions that make this attractive? I mean, are they things that you are thinking through about these experiments, that you do have quite pointed targets
in my case, it was just economic matter. This had to be done, and the circumstances were given in the opening of this new museum, Tabacalera. That was, we need to, this is quite complicated to organize and also expensive. So it was the, at that moment it was someone came and said, well, if you do it, then we pay for it. And so this is why I have been the papers. Afterwards, for instance, some things that they took an unexpected turn that I had to accept, because the scene of the stranded girl through the woods, it has completely different resonances in the Pays Basque than in other places, because the Pays Basque, with the years of terrorism and kidnapping and people going into under the ground for months and this kind of thing, well, then you know, Basque people have a lot to say about this kidnapping that was completely lost if you don't know this. Some people instantly recognize Basque country, which you, if you have been there, you will know it's a Basque country. And others not, but it was not planned like this. It was just a matter of circumstance when you make a film so expensive that you have to take every opportunity to, you know, to make it, because otherwise you will never make it. So some things, for instance, Basque is spoken in the film.
Maybe I could give you a short answer. It's not my idea, but something that I believe could maybe give you some tips about it. Boris Groys, the German philosopher, I don't know if it was Groys too in fashion, but Groys has this idea about what happened with the Western world after the fall of the wall in 1989. So the main idea is that after the wall came down, something very strange happened. And one of the consequences was that our imagination was smashed. Why? Because during the whole 20th century, we had this idea about utopia, this idea that about the future. If you take some look about the Soviet archives, for instance, we're gonna see how they really, they have the intention of colonize the other planets and so and so. So you have the space competition between Soviet Union, United States, etc., etc. So it's a bit idea that after the experience, the Soviet experience in the 20th century, our imagination has been like been a prisoner of the past. And if you look at the history and theory, we can understand how this is really exactly something new. Because if you're looking at some Walter Benjamin studies and about history, theses about history, you're going to find almost the same situation about how you be always been hunted by history somehow. So let's say that from the 19th century and 18th century, 17th century, there was always this strong relationship with the past. But now, after the 20th century, we are now back in the same kind of situation. We are somehow hypnotized by the past. And maybe the $1 million question is not exactly why you are stuck in this chamber of the past, but maybe not exactly how to get out of it, but how to build another kind of political utopia, able to liberate it and to open this door once again.
I mean, just to, nothing necessarily like adding too much, but I think, yeah, I mean, just to enumerate maybe like some of these obvious answers. I mean, like one is exactly what you said, I think the bankruptcy of the future, you know, and that this is inability to imagine the future, the structural, cultural data of this inability to make this projection. And indeed, you know, actually, we look at the 19th century, it's a, I mean, sure, obsession with the past has been there from the Renaissance, actually, and surely from the late 18th century. But actually, if we look closer to the different periods of the 19th century in Europe, it was exactly those moments of stale conservatism, of failed revolutions, of inability to imagine a different moment that have known the stalest type of historicist academism. So there is a connection. This inability to imagine a sense of progress in any sort, and an inability to move beyond past forms. But this is one thing. I mean, I think the other one, which again is somehow an obvious answer, but sure, surely in a time of globalized vocabulary of contemporary art, history brings specificity and brings difference of some sort. There is every historical moment has, even if the historicizing is itself a uniformizing kind of like gesture of the contemporary, but every story, every particular historical genealogy brings this specificity. I mean, another obvious example is also like with the market, because a lot of these remembrances are in times before the dominance of the market. So there's also way of resisting that, it's a way of connecting to a different possibility of operating. In some cases, also about saving figures who are now themselves, you know, very much part of the market system and had a path that was more free and genuine.
I'd like to venture that maybe this question of being stuck in history is a very local one. And you could say, which demographies are obsessed with the past? It's artists, authors, and cultural producers. And of course, this is just an apparition, but my impression is not that, well, most people are obsessed with the past at all. I would even go as far as saying that artists who have kind of a history in the avant-garde are now marginal, not because they're avant-gardists, but because they are looking at themselves in relation to into history, and this is becoming a more marginal position.
Maybe just to throw into this is that slightly disagree, because I think maybe I'm going to take an Anglo perspective on this, but the situation with what's happening in the United States and what happened with Britain, or at least England, with the recent Brexit vote, suggests that there is a very particular utopia or utopian vision from the past, which of course never really existed, of a safe, quote unquote, safe white demographic. And so that is very much an investment. Certain histories that kinds of similar processes happening concurrently, which perhaps complicate some of the ideas that we're thinking about here, particularly because so much of this work, very interestingly, has been about migration. You know, it's the migration of happening from one continent to another, the migration of show, again, from one continent to another, and then to another again. And the same thing happens with your shows too, Cosmic. So this is the relationship then between the migrations of time and the migrations of space. Maybe add some complexities to some of the discussion so far.
I
have to
say something quickly. So I think this idea of the same white fuzz is a typical, is an analytical term, a typical case of a screen memory. This has never existed. And in a way, the past doesn't exist. It's constantly being created. The moment you evoke it, you're creating that past, because the past, as such, it never existed. And it certainly doesn't exist now. In the case of the film, or with like many other projects, for me, it is a clear will to understand a present by trying to understand the mechanism of the past. So I think this idea of research is really true. It's not an empty world, but I think in your case as well, in what you were presenting in Italy, that is very clear. There are some things that happened and seem to have been forgotten that could change completely the way we look at the now. And therefore, it has to be brought back to the surface, almost like in a process of recovering this the real memory behind the screen memory.
But this is a very good. The next question is a very good one. Like, which kind of past we decide to invent, and how we in this process we are somehow create a kind of funeral every time.
What's the line about this funeral has no corpse?
And you don't think
that's one question for you. Yeah, no, I just
talking about funeral. No, it was a question I wanted to ask you about the two exhibitions that you were presenting, the exhibitions you were presenting earlier, and the one in South America. And I was wondering what's behind the decision of not involving the artists that were involved in the first exhibition in the second one. Did you have any thoughts about that? Because it seemed almost like a funeral in a way, because you were talking about a specific time where something specific happened, with a specific engagement. And from an artist's point of view, I'm asking myself, what would you then think when you were not included in the exhibition that were representing that time, that moment where you were in?
If I understood correctly, you're referring to the artists that were part of the timeline in 1984. Yeah. So, like Richard Prince was one of the artists. I think that the funeral happened already in the exhibition that Room Material did, because what they, in the funeral in the good sense of the word, I guess. Because from what you could see and from installation shots, they clearly did not believe in the autonomy of the artwork. No, it's like you go here, that goes there, your work goes below this other one. No? So the sacrality of the art object was already in question from the 1984 project. We didn't contact, because we were not doing the reenactment, we didn't contact directly the artist. Just looking also something that you were suggesting, like what is the past that we're creating? There's a term that in some of these art historical exhibitions that are done at Parasite, there's a term that you always seem to use, which is speculative art histories. No? By speculative, meaning not that they're not real, but that they're, the speculation can proceed to creating that narrative of a past. I don't know if you want to talk about speculation, but I don't know if you want to say, yeah.
Yeah, maybe I just, because I
just want to kind of add to that question of the funeral, the general question that I like that. I like the question of the funeral because the general question that led us in a way was the fact that exhibiting always has a funeralistic aspect to it because the thing, whatever you do with what you show, will never be the same. As it has been before. And I think in that kind of representational mode, I think anything that you touch and show or that you use for a curatorial argument is not what it has been. So that's why I wanted to come back also to the historicity and why do we suddenly encounter such an interest. I don't think we suddenly do, but I do think we do use exhibitions much more strongly than we ever. And my question would be whether this has to do with the fact that any curatorial way is one that relates multiple relations in a renewed way, and therefore not only is we interested in the past, which I think is not necessarily so, but is much more interesting in a constant production of meaning. So art histories could perhaps be art narratives. I'm curious to hear what you say about art histories.
Well, I basically had a digression now because of the funeral, because we currently have a Parasite solo exhibition with Richard Pong and Asta Kuhn, and it's a survey somehow of his non-cinematic work primarily. And when the exhibition was being put together, he constantly said, like, you know, this is not my funeral, so. that's why this was like a way to reject including too many of the earlier works or making it to either too celebratory or too revealing, too much exposing. So that's a term that he very strongly used. I think in the presentation we did, the shows, even I framed them together, they are very different actually. And in the case of the first one, it was a very different strategy. So in we used speculative for the first time in the case of the Taiping Tianguo exhibition. And, some of the connections that we started off with might have not been real. So we were open to that profoundly anti-historiographical possibility actually of faking a past and of creating a history that wasn't there. I mean, at the end, we were proven that was not the case somehow. But there was. An assumed and we were definitely ready for that possibility as well. Whereas in the case of the second exhibition, it was much more about conventional practice of art history. One of the most very positivistic idea of ultimately of comparing objects, of comparing and contrasting, and that kind of like very basic associative gesture. In the case of the third one, which we did together, it's a bit more complicated. Because again, it was a little bit about associating figures that were from very different histories and different contexts and perhaps forcing certain types of associations, but it was still within the realm of the possible.
Are there further questions from the audience? Well,
I didn't really ask your question.
I think what I
and we said that maybe this reference in this exhibition will also maybe change or might change our understanding of the exhibition as a form, or what kind of form the exhibition can actually take, and what then is the exhibitionary form as well. And because when I saw this film, I never thought about this before, but like when I saw this film, I thought about something that maybe I can quickly throw in. When I was in Salvador de Bahia this spring, where Marcelo created the third edition of the Bahia Biennial in 2014, and I was invited for a residency by the Goethe Institute. And so I did a little exercise, and I asked some of the art educators from 2014 to bring me to all the different places, because it was a biennial that was scattered all over the city, and to retell the exhibition, actually. And so that was my way to introduce myself to the city, its different politics, social dynamics, its history, memory, and so on, and also to get to know the different places, because it was in, from a monastery, a museum, a cinema, and so on. So when I say, like, understanding, actually, what do exhibitions do, or what kind of different, you know, form can they take, and how can they resonate, or how do they resonate, and when, and maybe how, what kind of effect does this have on our research? That was also, I think, something that I thought, like, following now these conversations, I think they are extremely rich, even so they are not, like, you know, maybe not formulated the final argument.
I was just.
Any other further? Or curious to continue?
Break.
Okay, then we have 5 minutes break, and we continue with our two last presentations. So, to give you, we will continue with Anthony, and then listen.